God's house, and certainly we got nice weather this morning, so, you know, we're kind of without excuse today, aren't we? But it is good to be here. Good to see you here. We definitely have families around us that need our prayers, as I learned this morning of the passing of Brother Butch's grandmother, Ms. Ollie. We certainly want to pray for that family and remember the family of Ms. Olive Meadows this morning, and certainly she's been a blessing for a long, long time. And also, Brother Steve mentioned that, I don't know if how many of you know him, but James Jones there in Decatur, he said that he had been taken to the hospital this morning unresponsive. They're thinking a heart attack possibly. So a lot of families to remember, a lot of people in need, our country. We need to pray for our country, for one another, and for those that are hurting round about us. But it's good to see you here today, and let's go ahead and get started this morning. Our lesson this morning is coming from Galatians chapter 2, and of course it's kind of a continuation of what we've been looking at over the last two or three weeks. And so as we start, like always, I want to take just a minute to kind of bring us up to speed or review last week's lesson for just a minute. So let's take a moment to reflect on what we talked about last week. Four quick points I'd like to mention this morning, and I say quick, I hope it'll be quick, so that we can get into what we need to talk about today and maybe get done on time. That'd be a blessing, wouldn't it? But four quick points. I knew somebody to chime in. Appreciate it, brother. But let's review what we were talking about last week, standing for the truth. You know, we live in a time right now where it's probably more important than it's ever been to stand for the truth and stand on what the Word of God says. And so I think there's some things that we talked about last week that we certainly want to reflect on for just a minute. First of all, one of the things we talked about last week is that the gospel is the same for all people. Folks, it don't matter who we are, it don't matter where we are, there's one gospel. And that's what we've been focusing on the whole time. There is one gospel. And people who teach otherwise are false teachers. There's one way to be saved, so therefore there's one gospel. Secondly, God does not show partiality. God is not a respecter of persons. You know, every person's got to get saved the same way. Doesn't matter if it's me or you or the President of the United States of America, whoever it is, there's one gospel. God is not a respecter of persons. We must all come to Him the same way. And who we are doesn't have any standing with God. Our money, our job, our social status, those things don't have any standing with God. Thirdly, once we've been saved, we should follow the Lord in baptism and join a scriptural New Testament church. You know, following the example, the first act of obedience, baptism, and then being faithful in a church, a godly church, one that preaches and teaches the Word of God. Join a New Testament church and be faithful to serve the Lord. And then finally, we should stay in the Word so that we can grow in grace and knowledge and we can serve the Lord as He would have us to and thus stand for the truth. You can't stand for the truth if you don't know the truth. And that's one of the things that we talked about last week, and that's been kind of a theme that's been a thread that's gone through all of our lessons. If we're going to stand on the truth, we must know the truth. That means we must read and study the Word of God. And we need to get serious about that. You know, well, there's always been a need for being serious about standing on the truth of the Word of God, but look around you. Just look around you at some of the things that are going on and some of the things that are being taught, even in churches today. It's more important probably than it's ever been to know the truth and stand on it. And folks, we need people who are born again and believe the gospel of Jesus Christ to take a stand. If you believe the gospel, if you are a child of God, live what you say you believe. Live what you say you believe. Far too long, too many Christians have compromised their beliefs in order to be politically correct. You've seen it. I've seen it. I've seen people that have claimed to be a child of God that didn't stand on something. Even had that discussion with people before, and I'm sure you have too. You know, One conversation comes to mind that I had with a man one time who was a Christian who said, and I won't get into the whole thing we were talking about, but he said, something's better than nothing. We were talking about versions of the Bible and handing out Bibles to kids at schools, what we were talking about, and the debate was over, or the discussion, it wasn't really a debate. The discussion was over what version of the Bible to give them. They were giving them a Bible that was kind of like a comic strip. It had illustrations there, and it read almost like a fictional book in paragraph form, not scripture and verse, and it had some of that kind of stuff. And I understand the idea. It was teaching some of the very basic beliefs of Christianity. But my thing was, why don't we just give them a Bible? Why don't we just give them a Bible, a King James Bible, that they can read for a lifetime and study? And the response was, well, you know, we've already bought these other Bibles. And then my response was, well, you can get I can get you a Bible free. Well, that's not really the point. This is what they want to give out. You know, and ultimately my thing was, and bottom line, it came down to this comment. I understand what you're saying, but giving them something is better than not giving them anything. I disagree with that. Giving them the truth is what they need. People are going to churches all over America this morning, and teachers and preachers are standing before them giving them something. They're giving them something, but they're not giving them the truth. So giving them something is not good enough. And that's the way we need to be when we live our life every day, folks. We need to give people the truth. We don't need to give them something. Something will lead them to hell. We need to give them the truth. So, we need to forget about political correctness. We need to forget about, and I'm not saying forget about what people think about us, because that's important. But when you're standing on the Word of God, there are going to be those that criticize, and we can't worry about that. We must stand true to the Word of God. We need to be like Paul in that he was committed to standing on the truth. Paul stood on the truth. Wherever he went, whoever he was talking to, he stood on the truth. It landed him in jail. It landed him in a lot of tight situations, but guess what? The Lord was always with him. The Lord always took care of him. The Lord always met his needs. Stand on the truth, no matter what it cost. Paul did that. Do we love the Lord enough to be that bold in the face of persecution today? You think about yourself. Do you love the Lord? Do I love the Lord enough to be bold like Paul in the face of persecution? Paul stood on the truth even when he knew it was going to land him in jail. He stood on the truth. Even when he knew that the people he was speaking to didn't want to hear it, he stood on the truth. Are we that bold today? I dare say that most of us today are not. Most of us today will shy away. Our country's in the shape it's in today primarily because people in the past have shied away, not willing to stand on thus saith the Lord. Now, let's look at today's lesson, justification by faith. Let me just begin the lesson today with a question. How are we justified? How are we justified? Are we justified by something that we do? Or are we justified by something that God does for us? Now, that's an easy question. Every one of us in here, we know the answer to that question. We are justified by what God has done for us. We can't justify ourselves. We can't save ourselves. And certainly, none of us in here would argue that. Salvation is of the Lord. We're saved by faith, not by works. How many times have you heard that said? How many times have you been told that? How many times has a preacher preached that or a Sunday school teacher said that? How many times have you ran across that in your reading and studying in the Word of God? We are saved by faith, not by our works. And after salvation, every child of God should study the Bible with a prayer that God would reveal the truth. We need to be seeking to learn more about the Lord. So many times today when people get saved, they never mature in Christ. They never read and study the Word of God. They never get any further than being a babe in Christ. Folks, if you've been saved for 10 or 15 years, you ought not be a babe in Christ. You ought to be mature in the Word. So we ought to be reading and studying our Bibles. And as we read and study the Bible, we must be willing to set aside our own ideas and our own prejudices so that the Word of God can be revealed to us and we can learn the truth. You know, folks, every one of us have our own prejudices. We have things that we believe are right. And we need to be able to set those things aside when we read and study the Word of God. Because if we don't, what we try to do is we try to manipulate the Word of God to say what we need it to say to fit what we believe. And folks, you can't read the Word of God that way. You must set your personal prejudices aside. Then we must build our faith on the foundation of the truth that is in Jesus Christ. Now that's what we must do. But let me go back to something I said just a moment ago. You know, how many times have we been told or heard or read that we are saved by faith, not by works? Many, many times. Then why is it that we seem as though we don't believe it? We say we believe it. It's been taught us all our life. We've heard it. Yet we seem to think that somehow or other what we do is going to make a difference. What we do is going to get us into heaven. Let's look at our verses this morning, Galatians chapter 2, beginning in verse 11. And we'll read the verses and then we'll talk a little bit about them. But when Peter was come to Antioch, I withstood him to the face because he was to be blamed. For before that certain came from James, he did eat with the Gentiles. But when they were come, he withdrew and separated himself, fearing them which were of the circumcision. And other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas was also carried away with their dissimulation. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, If thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? Now, a little background. As we look into these verses, Paul and Barnabas were ministers in the church there at Antioch, which, by the way, is where the disciples were first called Christians. At any rate, Paul and Barnabas were there, and as we see in verse 11, Peter arrives. And in verse 12, we see that when Peter first arrived there in Antioch, he ate with the Gentiles and he fellowshipped with them. Now, that's important. Peter came in amongst the Gentiles, he was fellowshipping with them, he was talking with them, he sat down and he ate with them. However, when a group of Jews in Antioch show up and confront Peter about his behavior, he withdrew from the Gentiles. He changed his actions because a handful of people had something to say. And after that point, he didn't have much else to do with the Gentiles. Now, let's stop there for just a moment and consider what had taken place. Folks, this is important. And this is something, and of course everything that we look at in the Word of God is something that we can apply to our life, but this is something that probably most of us are guilty of. Think about this. Was Peter wrong to eat with the Gentiles and fellowship with them when he first got there? Was that wrong? Was he doing something that wasn't right? Was he? Little interaction. He wasn't doing anything wrong, was he? He was doing just exactly what he was supposed to be doing. He absolutely was not doing anything wrong. Peter did what we do so many times, though. Rather than stand on the truth and correct those who were critical of his actions, he changed his behavior to please his critics. Is that not just like us? If we're doing something, and it doesn't necessarily have to be something that's godly, but that's what we're talking about this morning. If we're doing something that is from the Word of God that we have been instructed to do, that we know is right, and somebody comes along and questions us, rather than standing on the truth and saying, wait a minute now, let me explain to you why I'm doing what I'm doing, we just back down and just quit doing it. And you say, well, what's so wrong with that? It avoids controversy. Well, that's what's wrong in America today. Far too long, Christians have avoided controversy by failing to stand on the Word of God. And what we have now is all kinds of ungodly things being shoved down our throat. People have become more and more bold with their ungodly behavior. Things that are an abomination unto God are right in your face today. Why? Because we won't take a stand against it. We won't take a stand. We haven't taken a stand against it. Simply put, Peter was not willing to stand on the truth. Right there, he had an opportunity to set the record straight, and he shied away. Have you ever in your life had an opportunity to set the record straight? Have you in your life ever had an opportunity to stand for the Lord when somebody was watching that might have been weaker in the faith and just watching to see what you're going to do, and you just cower down? Just cower down. Just back away from an opportunity to stand on the Word of God, from an opportunity to serve the Lord, for an opportunity. You miss an opportunity. We miss an opportunity to live what we say we believe. The sad thing is that Peter's behavior also influenced others. Here's where the real tragedy is. Folks, what we do goes beyond just us. The way I live my life in my home affects my wife and it affects my children. The way I live my life in the workplace affects everybody I come in contact with. And the same is true for you. You know, I've had it said to me, and you probably have too, what I do is my business. I'm not hurting anybody else. Oh, yes, you are. Oh, yes, you are. Look at verse 13. And the other Jews dissembled likewise with him, insomuch that Barnabas was also carried away with their dissimulation. The other Jews followed Peter's example and withdrew from the Gentile believers. Why? Because that's what he did. When it was brought to his attention, hey, why are you doing this? He just backed away. He set a precedence, and others followed it. Even Barnabas got caught up in this dissimulation. Dissimulation, by the way, is hypocrisy. Hypocrisy. To say one thing and do another. That's what Peter did. That's what he did when he backed away. He had been preaching one thing, but when he got confronted with a group of people that didn't believe what he was saying, he backed away. Hypocrisy. How many of us are hypocrites? We don't like to use that word. I'm not a hypocrite. If you don't live what you say you believe, my friend, you are a hypocrite. Truth. Truth is a hard pill to swallow sometimes, but that's the truth. If we say one thing and we do another, we're a hypocrite, just like Peter was that day. And our hypocrisy, just like Peter's hypocrisy, causes others to stumble. Our hypocrisy causes lost people not to get saved. Our hypocrisy causes saved people not to live for the Lord. Paul, however, stood for truth. And he called Peter out. He told him the truth. Look at verse 14. But when I saw that they walked not uprightly according to the truth of the gospel, I said unto Peter before them all, if thou, being a Jew, livest after the manner of Gentiles, and not as do the Jews, why compellest thou the Gentiles to live as do the Jews? Paul simply called Peter out here. Paul made him face his hypocrisy. That's accountability, folks. That's something that's missing in our homes, in our workplace, in our church. Accountability is missing. Paul wasn't trying to run Peter down. He observed his hypocrisy. He saw what he was doing, and he called him out. He made him aware of it. He made him face it. Paul reminded Peter that he was not keeping the law by his actions. He was teaching the Gentiles that the Jews were right to keep the law. And my friends, that is hypocrisy. What he was telling them, what didn't line up with what he had been preaching to them. And Paul called his hand on it. Remember what we said about the law? He was telling them, now it's okay for you to keep that law. That's okay, we'll keep that law. You can keep that. And I'm going to back away, and I'm not going to offend you. I'm not going to say anything and I'm not going to interact with the Gentiles because you think that's wrong. And so, you know, we don't want to cause any offense among the Jewish people, when he should have told them the truth. He should have told them the truth. Let's read on in verse 15. We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith of Jesus Christ, even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. But if, while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also were found sinners, it is therefore, Christ the minister of sin? God forbid. For if I build again the things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. Look at that question. We're going to get to it, and I misspoke there, but look at that. Is therefore Christ the minister of sin? God forbid. We'll work our way back to that. But let's look in verse 15. We who are Jews by nature and not sinners of the Gentiles. The Jews obviously considered themselves to be righteous. They considered themselves maybe a little step above the Gentiles in this particular case, what we're seeing here. However, Paul pointed out that all Jews and all Gentiles are saved the same way. That's what we started out with our lesson today. Folks, there's only one gospel, and it's the same gospel. It was the same gospel for the Jew and the Gentile. It's the same gospel today for every man, woman, and child. The gospel does not vary depending on who you are or where you're from. We are all saved the same way. The same things are expected of every child of God. Whether you're black or white, Jew or Gentile, a person that gets saved and becomes a child of God, guess what? The expectations are the same for every one of them. There's not something that this group has to do that this group don't have to do. And that's what the Jews were saying. It's okay, we believe the Gentiles can get saved, but the Jews got to do this and the Gentiles got to do that, and we ought not fellowship with the Gentiles. That's not what the gospel says. It's not the truth. You can apply that today and we can say, well, this group of people, we know that they need to be saved, but they don't need to come to our church. We know that they need to be saved, but we don't need to be hanging around with them. We know that they need to be saved, but let them get it the best way they can. We don't need to go over there and witness to them. Is that not being just like the Jews were in Paul's day? Is that not the same thing? It is hypocrisy. It's hypocrisy in its greatest form, and we are guilty of it today. Most every one of us are guilty of it in some shape, form, or fashion. The ground, my friends, is level at Calvary. It don't matter who you are, don't matter what country you live in, don't matter what language you speak, don't matter what color your skin is, one gospel. It's the same for everybody, and the ground is level at Calvary. No matter what our name is or any of those other things we've talked about. So then, can we keep the law and save ourselves? Can we? No. Look at verse 16. Knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but by the faith in Jesus Christ. We can't justify ourselves by keeping the law because we can't keep the law. That's already been established. Even we have believed in Jesus Christ, that we might be justified by the faith of Christ and not by the works of the law. For by the works of the law shall no flesh be justified. We see very clearly here in this verse that no one has ever been justified by the works of the law. The law will not save you. The law will not save you. But rather it is faith in Jesus Christ that justifies us and makes us right with God. We come to God in faith, or we don't come to Him at all. There's one way, not many ways. We do it God's way, or we don't do it at all. If we say we're born again, yet we didn't come according to what the Word of God teaches to God, we are not saved. There's one way. You can't work your way there. You're not saved because of works. You're not saved because your dad was a pastor or your dad was a deacon. You're not saved because you got a highly respected family name. You're not saved by the color of your skin. Those things don't matter. In verse 17, we see that no matter how sure we are concerning our salvation, we are still sinners in our flesh. Now, wait a minute. I thought you said when you get saved, you become a new creature in Christ. Now you just turn around and say, we're sinners after salvation. How so? Look at verse 17, first part of verse 17. But if while we seek to be justified by Christ, we ourselves also are found sinners. When we are saved, we become a new creature indeed. Yes, we do. And a new nature is born in us. That's what the Word of God teaches, and we know that to be so. However, that new nature is contained in a fleshly body. And that fleshly body is inherently sinful. Our body, our flesh, desires the things of this world. It desires sin. And it's a constant fight between that new inward creature that we are and this old fleshly body that we abide in. Also, look in verse 17, toward the end of the verse there, we find a question. Is therefore Christ the minister of sin? Is he? Is Jesus Christ the minister of sin? No. No. How then is it that once we've been saved, we're a new creature, we're a child of God, but we sin? Is that okay? Does that make Jesus a minister of sin? The answer is no. Jesus is certainly not a minister of sin. So what Paul is talking about here is something just a little bit different. What was he talking about? What was Paul trying to say? What was his message to the people in what he was saying here? The fact that we sin after we are saved does not make Jesus a minister of sin. It makes us a transgressor. Look at verse 18. For if I build again things which I destroyed, I make myself a transgressor. I make myself a transgressor if I build again the things that have already been destroyed. When you become a child of God and you are saved and you become that new creature within, if you go back to your old lifestyle, you are a transgressor. You have torn down what's already been built, what's already been made right. And you know better. You know better. You know, lost people sin, why? Because that's all they know. Lost people sin because they're lost. When a child of God sins, what we've got to do in order to sin is to say, okay, I know this is wrong, but I'm going to do it anyway. A little different ballgame, isn't it? For a lost person to sin, they sin and don't think anything about it because they're lost. But for a saved person to sin, they know better. They got to say, I know the truth, but either I don't believe the truth, or either it's okay, or we find all kind of ways to justify it. You see, as saved people, if we go back to what we were before salvation, we are a transgressor. And I suspect that most of us can point to a time in our life when we've been a transgressor. I suspect most of us, I'll have to say in my case for sure, I can't speak for you, I can speak for me. But in my case, I will say this, there has been a time in my life after salvation when I went back. I went backwards instead of forward. How did I get there? I got there, number one, by not reading my Bible like I should. And I've told you all this before, I'll share it again this morning. When you quit reading the Bible like you should, quit praying like you should, then you miss a church service here and there, and it bothers you at first, but then it gets to where it don't bother you. And before you know it, you're not reading your Bible, you're not praying, and you're not going to church. Now, if you don't engage in any godly activities, how do you expect to walk with the Lord? You're not walking with the Lord. When you quit reading the Bible, quit praying, and quit going to church, the only influences you're seeing in your life are ungodly ones. And you're stepping backwards. You're not stepping forward. As a child of God, we ought to be every day trying to pursue the Word of God. Every day seeking to be a better child of God than we were yesterday. That's what we ought to be doing. And if we're not doing that, we're not walking with the Lord. Not like we should. Now, that doesn't mean we're lost. It means we're not doing what we ought to be doing as a child of God. We must stand on the Word of God. But to do it, we got to know it. So then, Paul was pointing out to Peter that he was a transgressor. Look at that. Now, that's pretty bold words to call Peter a transgressor, but look at what he did. He was a transgressor because he was going back to the Mosaic law. He was going back to what the Jews said, all right, here's what the law says now, and you're doing something that the law says don't do. But Paul also pointed out to Peter that his actions were hypocritical. You see, it was Peter who said in Acts 10:34 that God was no respecter of persons. Peter's getting called out on his own words. The very things he had taught in the past, he was living contrary to this day. Folks, think about that for a minute. Think about that for a minute. Have you ever done that? As I was reading this lesson and studying, I began to think about, you know, you stand up and you teach Sunday school, and you teach things from the Word of God, and you read things from the Word of God, and you present them in a Sunday school class, and then the very things that you teach, you don't do yourself. The very things that I stand up here and say, as a child of God, this is what we ought to be doing, and then I'm not doing it. What does that make me? It makes me the same thing Peter was that day. It makes me a hypocrite. That's what it makes me. The legalist Jews in Antioch had caused Peter to change his mind about what he had been preaching and teaching. And I don't know that Peter changed his mind. Let me back off of those words. I don't know that Peter changed his mind. Peter just avoided controversy and he backed down. He may have still believed the truth. He just wasn't willing to stand on it. And that brings us to another point. How many times have we known something was wrong, yet we didn't take a stand? You ever been around something that was going on that you knew was wrong, and you just stood there in silence and let it go on? Folks, we can look at Peter and we can say, I can't believe he did that. I can't believe he did that. Yet we do the same thing. We can't see it in our own lives. We are just like him. We're no different. The fact is that rather than standing on the truth, Peter gave in to the Jewish prejudices and Paul held him accountable. That's what we're looking at right here. That's exactly what we've just seen. One man failing to stand on the Word of God and another man holding him accountable. Is anything wrong with that? Nothing wrong with that. That's what the Bible teaches us to do. Hold one another accountable. Yes, we do. Yes, we do. And Brother Butch makes a very interesting point. We need more people to be like Paul today. But then all of a sudden people say, well, Paul was Paul. He was a great man of God. I can't be like, why can't you be like Paul? Paul was a persecutor of God's people. Paul was as nasty as they get. And the Lord saved him. And he was faithful to serve the Lord after which the Lord had saved him. Why can't we be like Paul? There's no reason we can't. Instead of saying Paul was a great man of God and we could never be like him because God dealt specially with Paul, what we ought to say is, I could never be like Paul because I don't want to be like Paul. That's why we're not like Paul. We don't want to be like him. We don't want to do that. Because it would mean we'd have to give up something in our own life. Look at what it cost Paul in worldly things. Look at what Paul gave up to follow the Lord. And the fact is, most of us are not willing to do that. We'll serve the Lord as long as it don't cost us a dime or cause us to have to get out of our comfort zone and do something. But if it starts getting in our pocket and it starts costing us to have to take some of our time to do something, we're not going to do it. We're not going to do it. If it means we might have to stand against somebody that's respected in the community, we're not going to do it. Not going to do it. That's the difference in us and Paul. He was willing, and we're not. And I, you know, I'm as guilty as anybody of sitting there saying, well, and thinking. I was thinking as I was reading some of this stuff, you know, I try to be faithful. I try to do what I know I'm supposed to be doing as a child of God. And then I look at my miserable efforts. And they are miserable. Because I'm just like what I just said. If it means I got to do something a little different, I look back at my life. Have I ever done anything that really cost me? That really cost me? To stand for the Lord? Have I ever had an opportunity to really stand for the Lord and back down? Yep, I have. I've had opportunities to be that person that could stand there and say, look, here, whoa, that's wrong. That's wrong. Here's why it's wrong. And then if people go on and do what they do, you've told them the truth. But I've been guilty of being the one to stand there and just not say nothing. Just don't say nothing. Most of us have. But folks, that's wrong. That's being hypocritical. We say we love the Lord. We say we believe what the Word of God says, but we won't do it. We're just like Peter. And the world we live in today, the world that our kids are growing up in, our grandkids are growing up in, is a mess because of it. When we look around the world today, and around our country today, we want to blame the president. It's not the president's fault. We elected him. Now you might say, I didn't vote for him. The majority of the people in this country elected him. Whose fault is that? Ours. We didn't take the gospel to him. We didn't stand on thus saith the Lord. If saved people were voting, they wouldn't have voted for him in the first place, and he wouldn't be our president. Now we need to be praying for his salvation. How many of us pray for him every day? How many of us pray for his salvation? Verse 19 tells us that when we are saved, we are dead. And I'm getting ahead of myself, but we are dead to the law. And we are made alive through God. Let's look at verse 19. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. Folks, what the application is here, Peter let those people come to him and say, well, here's what the law says, and Peter gave in. And Paul had to remind him, you're being hypocritical. He had to remind him, that's not what you've been teaching. That's not what the gospel says. Look at verse 19. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. Let's read on. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness come by the law, then Christ is dead in vain. And folks, that kind of sums up everything we've been talking about here this morning. Kind of brings it all to a head there, so to speak. The law can't save us. If we could keep the law and be righteous, then Jesus died for nothing. If you and I could save ourselves, then Jesus' death on the cross was for nothing. But we know that not to be true. We know that is not the case. The law does have a purpose. The law is our schoolmaster. The simple fact is that the law has accomplished its purpose when it has shown us our sin, when it has shown us our guilt, when it has shown us our inability and our need for somebody else. In other words, when the law has shown us our need for the Lord, it has accomplished its purpose. That's what being our schoolmaster means. It has brought us to a point that we know, hey, these laws, we can't keep them. It's impossible for us to keep them. No matter how hard we try, we can't keep them, because we know that if we fail in one, we failed in all. And so we need the Lord. We need the Lord. Verse 19. For I, through the law, am dead to the law, that I might live unto God. When we're saved, we are dead to the law, and we are made alive through Christ. He lives in us. How are we made alive through Christ? Look at verse 20. Verse 20 gives us the answer. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. There's the answer. There's the answer, how we are made alive through Christ. When we are saved, the old man dies. The old man dies. And we are filled with the Holy Spirit. We become a new creature in Christ Jesus, as we talked about at the very beginning today. And at this point, our life takes a new direction. We now live by faith in Jesus Christ, who died for our sin. That's what's happened to us as saved people. Now, if you're sitting here this morning and you say, well, I believe I was saved, but I can't ever really remember a real change in direction. I can't ever really remember giving myself to God. I don't know if I've really ever for sure done that. I've been going to church a long time. I shook a preacher's hand. I got baptized. Folks, these words were not said to me, but they were told to me by someone who witnessed to a man. And he was asked specifically about his salvation. He said, have you ever trusted in the Lord for salvation? And his response was, well, I guess that's what I did when I shook the preacher's hand and joined the church. Folks, that don't sound like confidence to me. It don't sound like salvation to me. Because if all you've ever done is shaken the preacher's hand, joined the church and got baptized, you're lost. If that's all you've ever done, you're lost. Being a member at Cedar Grove Baptist Church will not save you. Being a member at any other church will not save you. Shaking a preacher's hand, I don't care who he is, will not save you. And that water won't save you either. And so, when you're asked if you are truly saved, if you've been born again, and you say, well, I think so. I shook a preacher's hand and I joined the church. If that's what makes you think so, please examine your walk with the Lord. Please examine your walk with the Lord. I'm not saying you're lost. I'm saying if that's all you ever did. You know, I remember, I really believe I got saved as a child at 12 years old. I believe that. I didn't always live like that. I was a transgressor. But I remember getting saved at 12. And I remember going to school excited. I couldn't wait to get to school and tell folks at school. And that was met with mixed results. mostly not positive. There were a couple of positive responses, but most of them said, you did what? What you talking about? Most of them didn't understand what I was talking about. And that didn't bother me too much. And I was excited for a while. But my excitement began to fade. And when my excitement began to fade, I didn't really go any further with it. And I stayed a babe in Christ for a long time. I didn't mature. And then I quit reading my Bible. And I quit praying. I quit going to church like I should. One of the main reasons, and I'll tell this in front of her sitting here this morning, by the time I got to college, I wasn't really acting like a saved person. And one of the main reasons I came to church when I was home on the weekends from college is because Mama made me. One of the main reasons. Then after I got on my own, I knew I ought to go to church. And Angela and I got married, and knew we ought to go to church. And we went for a while, and things were going pretty good. But then we slowly but surely fell out. Mama wasn't there to make me anymore. But you know what? Mama making me go to church wasn't doing much good. It made Mama feel good, and it made me come listen to preaching that convicted me. That's why I didn't want to come. Because I knew everything he was saying was true. That's another way you can know that you're saved. When you listen to the preaching of the Word of God and you're not doing right and it convicts you, not for salvation, it convicted me that I know I wasn't supposed to be doing some of the stuff I was doing. I couldn't wait to get out of there so he'd hush. Most of you have been there. I got to get out of there so he will hush. So I can get on about my business. I got things to do. I was doing that. The next time I got called out, it wasn't by mother. It was by God himself through my child. And I really believe that was my last opportunity. I believe that. But I always can go back to when I was 12 years old sitting in vacation Bible school, and I still today believe I got saved that day. I just didn't live like it. For a long time. Didn't live like it. And folks, if we can go back to a point when we were truly born again, and we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we are truly saved, and this is my point of all of that. If you know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are born again, live like it. Purpose in your heart today to serve the Lord. Live for God. There's something that every one of us can do for the Lord, and we ought to be busy doing it every day. But as we look back, if we can't say, well, you know what? I know I got saved. If we can't say that, then we need to make that right first. We need to make that right first. Because you can't serve the Lord if you're lost. Can't serve the Lord if you're lost. So my desire for us this morning, for each one of us, is to examine ourselves. In conclusion, I'd like to simply say this and ask really a couple of questions. Number one, what is the purpose of the law? What is the purpose of the law? We know the purpose of the law is to be a teacher to bring us to Christ. And number two, how are we justified? How are we justified? Well, we're justified by faith in Christ, not by the works of the law. Now, that's pretty easy, isn't it? That's easy. These questions are so easily answered, yet there is so much confusion concerning the gospel today. How is that? How is it that we have made something that's so easy, so complicated? Folks, there's only one gospel. Every man, woman, and child is saved the same way, and we know what to do. If you've been born again, if you've been truly saved, get serious about serving the Lord. Stand on the truth. Do not compromise what you believe. We need to learn a lesson from Peter. Folks, our family needs us to do that. Our children need to see us as parents be faithful to stand on the Word of God and don't compromise. Our grandkids need to see us as Christians, be faithful and stand on the Word of God and not compromise. I really believe if I don't see it in my lifetime, my two little grandsons that are running around here one day are going to have to stand. I may have to, but I really believe one day they're going to be confronted and they're going to have to say yes or no. And it's going to mean something. It is going to mean something. Where will they stand? Are they going to look at me and say, well, my granddad was an example. He stood on the truth and he believed the truth and he lived the truth. Or are they going to look and say, well, my granddad, he said it, but he didn't really stand on it, so I don't really see the need for me to stand on it. That's what kind of difference it makes. That's what kind of difference it makes. Just like others were watching Peter, others are watching us. Commit yourself to serving the Lord. Stand on the Word of God. Believe, live what you say you believe. And first of all, make sure you believe the truth. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this day. God, I thank you for the truth that your Word reveals to us. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity we have to come and to study your Word and to look into your Word. And God, I thank you for the truth that you reveal to us as we are faithful to read and study your Word. And God, I pray that each person in this sanctuary this morning, God, can look back to their life and know that they're truly saved. And God, I do pray today, if there's one in here this morning, Lord, that can't say that, Lord, today would be the day of their salvation. And then, Lord, I pray for each one of us in here that we'd get serious about our walk with you, our service to you, that we'd realize and know that, God, time is short. We don't have a lot of time. And, Lord, not only that, others are watching us, and our actions and the things that we say and the things that we do are leading people in one direction or the other. And, God, I pray that each one of us would be faithful to lead folks to you. Lord, just help us, give us the strength and the courage and the boldness that we need to stand on the Word of God each and every day. And not to compromise on what we know to be the truth of the gospel. Lord, we just pray for our services today. I pray for Brother Mark as he comes and leads us as we worship you in song this morning. And Lord, for Brother Steve as he brings the message today. God, I just pray that you'd give him the strength and the boldness and the courage to proclaim your Word, Lord, just as you'd have him to. And Lord, I pray that you'd prepare our hearts to take the words that we hear today and God, apply them to our life, that we'd leave here, Lord, different from the way that we came. That we'd leave here, Lord, and go out into the world each day and, Lord, serve you and live for you and be an example to those that are around us. And most of all, that we'd stand on your Word, Lord, that we'd be counted as a child of God. Lord, we love you and we thank you and we ask these things in your most holy and precious name. Amen. Well, thank y'all for your attention.